Can I now ask you to give a very warm welcome to Dawood Abdallah from the British Muslim Initiative, who's played such a huge role in Stop the War Coalition and done so much to mobilise Muslim youth in particular against the war on terror and in support of the work of the Stop the War Coalition. Dawood Abdallah.
Thank you, Jeremy, and thank you for your warm welcome. As we go forward in the sessions today, to take stock of this war on the 10th anniversary, I think it is important that we review the objectives which were stated in the beginning in order to understand how we are and why we got here today. My view is that this enterprise was ideologically driven from the very beginning. It was not a war of necessity, but one of choice, taken essentially to lay the foundation for what was then called the Project for New America in the 21st century. Advices were given by so-called experts and institutions, and of course the protest movement, the Stop the War campaign, on the streets of London and Paris and all over Europe, stating that this was going to be a disaster and that there were options, international policing options, legal options to deal with what happened in New York in September 2001. But the Bush administration at the time, the Republican Party, their decision was already made up to occupy certain countries for strategic reasons, to ensure that they could meet the challenges of this century. That is the first view I think it is important to come to grips with. But the war was fought on loans, with loans, from England and the United States and all the coalition of the willing. They didn't have the money. And by 2020, we would be repaying something in the region of $4.4 trillion. This is a debt that will not be paid off in the near future. This is the reality, the economic cost of it, because we didn't have the money to fight this war. There were, of course, a huge human cost. The most conservative estimates of deaths in the West is at least 500,000. If you ask people in Iraq or Afghanistan, the numbers would be much more. And even so, when we speak about for every one direct death in the war, whether it's in Iraq or Afghanistan, there are four indirect deaths. So ultimately, the human cost is well over or close to, I would say, 2 million at the very least. And how many have been made refugees? How many have been dispossessed and dislocated across the world as a result of this? And we are no nearer to an end. We've heard by our previous speaker. New fronts have been opened up in Yemen, in the Horn of Africa, in North Africa. It's a war that's ongoing without any vision of an end in sight. Mr. Obama, in December 2011, when he was leaving, withdrawing his troops from Iraq, said what? We are leaving a stable and self-reliant Iraq. This is what he was saying. December 2011. That is a country, last year they sold more than $100 billion worth of oil. And when there were floods in Baghdad, rains in Baghdad this last month, they couldn't even prevent the sewage from overflowing onto the streets. $100 billion worth of oil. People in Iraq are asking, where is the money? Well, the explanation is simple. The big companies who went into Iraq Halliburton got contracts before the war started. Before the war started. It explains it. It explains the reason why they went to war. Financial gain, strategic positions, in the case of Afghanistan, using Afghanistan as a base to have a foothold or to expand influence in Central Asia. These were the calculations of the West. The case of Iraq or Afghanistan is no different from that of Iraq. Today what we have, Bush, he said before they went into Iraq that they wanted to break the so-called axis of evil. Who were they? Iran, Iraq, North Korea. What's the position of Iran today? Iran has more influence in the region than it had in 2003 as a result of this war. See? So the contradictions counterproductive, you see, results are staggering. But of course, in the case of Iraq, there's fragmentation, regionalism, ethnic divide, sectarian divide. All of that has been entrenched. They, as a result of the war, we remember the talk of democracy. What we had now, a system. Paul Bremer, when he was appointed governor, protector of Baghdad, what did he do? Set up a quota system so that Shiites would have so many seats and Sunnis so many seats. Kurds will have so many seats, and now we have a country that is fragmented, almost on the verge of division into regional and sectarian divides. Karzai last week in The Guardian, in his interview with The Guardian, he said this: Helmand is no more secure, or it was more secure before the British came. By his own admission, it is more secure. And of course, there are other fallouts. The impact on civil liberties in Britain, in France, the discourse about Muslims and so-called Islamist terrorists that paved the way for this man in Norway, Anders Breivik, to kill dozens of young children in the name of fighting what the advance of Islam into Europe. So, in the end, those who have benefited from this enterprise are not the British people, its economy, its people of the United States and the coalition of the willing. Those who have benefited have been Mr. Blair and the Bush and the Halliburtons, the Dick Cheneys. You see, they have benefited. How much has Mr. Blair done now? The most conservative estimate is 20 million a year because of this enterprise. They've used human rights, they've used democracy, they've used international law to advance their personal gains at the expense of our peoples, at the expense of our economies, at the expense of our security and stability and development, and they should be brought to account for it. Thank you.